So let's talk about illusions. Sometimes our minds play tricks on us, and we see or hear things that just aren't there. This isn't superstition or pseudoscience, it's a fact about our brains. And some of our strategies in how we process language can make our perceptions swerve away from reality. So let's take a listen and hear just what can go wrong. I'm Moti Lieberman, and this is The Ling Space.
Welcome to The Ling Space.
So like we've said before, just having a normal conversation is actually really hard. Speech comes at you super fast, like often a couple of hundred words a minute. And beyond that, the world is a noisy, noisy place. There are cars whizzing by, and wind blowing around, and other people having their own conversations that you don't really need to listen to. So just dealing with the background noise to your conversation is a real challenge. But let's forget about what's happening around you, and just focus on the conversation you're trying to have. Even there, it's no walk in the park. First, you have to adjust to the way that your friendly conversation partner actually puts their words out into the world. Even if they speak the same language as you, even if they speak the same dialect, there's still going to be some variation in the way that they talk. The melody of their sentences, the way they craft their vowels, there's always something to get used to with everyone. And even once you get used to the little peculiarities of the verbal cannon lobbing rapid-fire words at you, there's still variation within the way that we talk. We don't pronounce things exactly the same way every time that we get them out of our mouth. There's always little differences one time to the next. Some of the variations follow predictable patterns based on where the sound shows up. So like, K sounds different when you pronounce it in key or scoop. But even when we try to make the exact same sound, we're still not perfect. And when we're listening, we have to account for that. Now, we're totally well equipped for all of this. Because we expect there to be all sorts of variation in what we're hearing, we have all sorts of strategies to deal with it, and we deploy them super quickly. Like, take for example a 2004 study that looked at how native English speakers dealt with speech from two different groups. They heard other native English speakers, or second language learners of English whose first language was either Spanish or Chinese. The researchers found that, as you might expect, they had the easiest time with the native English group. But that advantage lasted for basically a minute. Once they'd been listening to the non-native speech for only a minute, all the English got processed about the same. So yeah, we get better quickly, even in situations that start out tough. But here's the thing, this all has to come at a cost. If we're going to be able to adapt so quickly to noisy environments, unfamiliar accents, and the little wiggly bits in the way everyone pronounces everything, we're going to need some top-notch processing strategies. And if we have mental machinery powerful enough to overcome all of these problems, once in a while we're going to hear things that aren't there, or process things in a way that doesn't match what actually happened. Like, take for example something that we talked about a few episodes ago. Sometimes our brains can compensate for sounds that have been replaced by other sounds or just dropped out of words entirely. Not to pull the same trick twice, but did you notice that earlier I said example instead of example? Probably not, because when I said take for example, you knew what you were supposed to hear, and that was the word example, with some rock-solid g right in the middle. So you just charitably filled it in for me. Thanks! This illusion is known as phoneme restoration, and it's more nuanced than it first appears. Like, let's take a sentence from a classic experiment that first looked at this neat trick. The state governors met with their respective legislatures convening in the capital city. In the original study, the s in the middle of legislatures got replaced with a cough the exact same length as the s. But the participants in the study reported that they heard the full legislatures, complete with s. Not only that, but they heard the cough too, except they said they heard it before or after legislatures. So these people didn't just sub in a sound that wasn't there, they turned the cough to background noise and then kicked it out of the word entirely. And lest you think, well, that's just one sound, we can replace one sound easy. Participants behaved the same way when the whole gist syllable was replaced with a cough too. But even when we have only one word, we can use what we know about our language to work out what was probably said. So I'm going to give you a bunch of sounds here, like basically a word, and I'm going to cover my mouth while I do it so you can't read my lips. Splash. What did you hear? You probably heard splash, right? Well, maybe this isn't a surprise by now, but there wasn't actually any sound between the s and the l. But as we've talked about before, when you make stop sounds like p, t, and k, the airflow through the mouth gets totally blocked for a bit. So they all sound the same when you make the consonants by themselves, like. So when you hear nothing, you figure it's got to be one of those sounds. So then, why do you hear the word as splash? Well, you have three choices as an English speaker for what that sound could be. But you also know how English syllables work, and that lets you solve the problem. Stl isn't a good way to start a syllable of English. Like, we don't have any word like sklout. And while we do have skl at the beginning of a word, it's way less common than spl. So you fill in the silence with a p and you get splash. Even though what I actually said was sklash. Did I trick you? Okay, so now that we're done with being tricky, why does this work? Why don't we just listen to what people are saying and then get the right meanings? Well, of course, we do that too. Otherwise, we'd never be able to work out what people are trying to say in unpredictable situations. Like this. When I went to the beach, I brought my ferret. Now, ferrets are not things that you bring to the beach normally. But you can work it out, even though you would never have guessed I'm a ferret beacher. That's because we have two different systems for processing speech. We have bottom-up processing, where we pay attention just to the sounds that we hear and match them up to things in our mental dictionary. That's what lets you understand unpredictable things. But the world is noisy, right? If you just relied on hearing things correctly and then processing them, you'd be losing meanings all the time. So we also have top-down processing. In top-down processing, we use our knowledge about language and about the world to work out what's likely being said. And the thing is, we use both kinds of processing all the time. They're both at work when we hear speech. Without top-down, we'd need everything to be perfectly silent and perfect conversation partners saying everything perfectly. But without bottom-up, we wouldn't be able to work out words or meanings that were hard to guess from the context. I mean, we wouldn't even really be able to interpret any of the things people were saying. You sort of need to translate sounds into words for that. And we really, really want to do that. We humans like language a whole lot, and we want to hear it even when it's not, well, actually language. An interesting example comes from the work of Austrian composer Peter Ablinger. He took a recording of human speech and then broke it down into the component sounds that made it up. So like warbly clusters of frequencies that he interpreted as musical notes. Then he linked up mechanical pistons, which can move way faster than human fingers, to the 88 keys on a piano. And when he programmed them to play the clusters of notes that he got from the speech recording, what came out was something that really does sound like a talking piano if you put your mind to it. We've got a link down in the video description. If you just listen to the piano by itself, you might not be able to hear the words. But once you're given captions and you know what the piano is supposed to be saying, everything changes. This kind of combination of using your eyes and ears to work out what's being said is also behind another super cool phonological illusion, the McGurk effect. The best way to introduce this is to just show it to you, and it's got to be up close. So watch me as I speak. Ba, ba, ba. What do you hear? You probably heard three da's, right? That's because your mind is combining the visual of me saying ga with the audio of me saying ba. And you average it out and end up with the sound in between those two, so da. Try going back and just listening to it without watching, or watching it without any audio, and you can clearly tell what sound I'm making. But even if you know what I'm doing, you still hear da if you watch and listen to it at the same time. Just so cool! So the tactics we've developed to deal with the harsh realities of language in a noisy, imperfect world make our lives much easier. But they do get our minds tied up chasing phantom sounds or inserting things that aren't there some of the time. It's a small price to pay, though, and I don't think that life would be very interesting if we didn't get to keep some of our illusions. So we've reached the end of the Ling space for this week. If you filled in all my silences, you learned that there's a lot of noise and variability that we have to sift through to understand speech. That we use two kinds of processing to deal with these challenges, top-down and bottom-up. That because of this, we can get tricked into hearing sounds and syllables that aren't really there. And that we want to hear speech so much, sometimes we even turn non-language things into words. The Ling Space is produced by me, Moti Lieberman. It's directed by Deleuze Prévost, and it's written by both of us. Our editor is Georges Coulomb, our production assistant is Stefan Herdebees, our music is by Shane Turner, and our graphics team is Atelier Muse. We're down in the comments below, or you can bring the discussion back over to our website where we'll have some extra material on this topic. Check us out on Tumblr, Twitter, and Facebook, and if you want to keep expanding your own personal Ling Space, please subscribe. And we'll see you next Wednesday. Tot ziens!